Welcome, everybody. My name is Marcel Holtmann. I work for the Open Source Technology Center at Intel, and I will give you a story on how we actually wrote another wireless daemon for Linux, what it does, what it can do, and what our intentions were. As usual with my other two presentations earlier, nice disclaimer. I'm not repeating all of this, but Linux is a trademark of Linus Torvalds. The Wi-Fi Association has a bunch of trademarks. You can read them by yourself. LTE is a trademark, the NFC mark is a trademark, and Bluetooth is also a trademark of the Bluetooth SIG. And there will be probably more, but they're all owned by the respective owners. Quick about myself, I keep this really quickly. I maintain the Bluetooth stack for Linux since around 2004, so that has been a long time. In that time, while doing that one, I've created a connection manager for Linux, ConnMan, similar to Network Manager, but has been used in actually embedded products like the Nest thermostat and so on and so forth. So that has been wildly used on devices that actually get out in the field and get a lot of testing. We developed a telephony stack that still runs in certain devices in some areas. Allegedly, it is driving a bus in somewhere in Russia, so it's all good. We also did a proxy daemon called PackRunner for handling all the proxy needs and all integrated nicely. And if you've been to my previous presentation, there are two pieces on this one for my introduction slide. I'm actually talking about these two pieces today and give you an overview on these ones, and so we'll see this. I joined OTC, I joined Intel in 2007, so that's my 10 years running now for Intel, and has been quite an interesting ride in open source and what we have achieved by then. Before I continue, I want to give a little bit extra credit since this is not all my own work. So Dennis Kensio, Andrew Zabrowski, Tim Kurt, Raul, and Matt Martineau have been actually really heavily helping us to get this code base up and running and doing fixes for the Wi-Fi stack in Linux, for the kernel, for the crypto subsystem, and a lot of other pieces. Without these people, I would have never been that far as we are right now. So extra credit to these guys. So when I started at Intel about 10 years ago, this was pretty much the basic vision that we had and we wanted to get to it. So the idea was we have our hardware, we have a bunch of Linux kernel drivers, we have a bunch of Linux subsystems or equivalent things that we want to support. And this goes really from NFC to Bluetooth Classic. In the meantime, Bluetooth Low Energy came along, Bluetooth Mesh is coming along soon. 15.4 became more relevant in the later years, has been around a long time, but with the introduction of Thread and a lot more Zigbee devices, 15.4 is more relevant than Wi-Fi, of course, 3G, then LTE came along, and so on and so forth. But the idea was pretty much the same. We had drivers that talk to the hardware, then we have subsystems who can actually manage them, and then we have a connection manager, that's where ConnMan came in, that can handle all of these ones and expose them nicely and treat them all the same so we actually can have a unified view of them. And then you have the applications dealing with this one. So if you need an internet connectivity or anything else, the application have a unified view on this one. So that was the basic idea about 10 years ago, how we wanted to go about this. We made progress and we got to a state where this actually looks kind of on the way how we wanted it. So we have subsystems for almost everything. So we have an NFC subsystem that got created in that time. We always had a Bluetooth subsystem, but it got extended with low energy support. And you will see soon also Bluetooth mesh support once that standard gets ratified sometime this year. We have improvements for the 15.4 subsystem and seen drivers happening, new hardware spins, self-built hardware, new spins of that hardware. And even lately, a company said, oh, we're going to build this, and here's the driver for it, which is great. We always had the wireless subsystem, but that has seen also a lot of improvements over the last 10 years. The only difference where we never had a kernel subsystem for is 3G and LTE, and I don't think this will ever happen because these things are easier done in user space. So we have a large abstraction area that's done in user space. That still means you have some hardware drivers like QMI or UART drivers or with Nokia ISI or with ST Ericsson. I forgot how they called this now. That's some subsystem as well. So they're mini helper subsystems, but they all were hardware specific, and we did the rest of the unification in user space. And then we had the daemons on top of it. So for NFC, we have the NearD daemon. For BlueZ, we always had the Bluetooth daemon. For 3G and LTE, we had Ophono then. The problem part has been always Wi-Fi, since there has been WP supplicant, but that's not really a daemon. That's just something that implements a supplicant and does a little bit more. And I'll get into the details. So this one, this slide, we have the, it's ConnMan plus the supplicant that does your Wi-Fi. But we really wanted to get to that ConnMan can be doesn't have to do any Wi-Fi handling. So we in the weird spot that everybody else is nicely abstracted into other subsystem and daemons, but for Wi-Fi, we had to go one level down and break layer separation. That's bad. And obviously, they're missing something for 15.4, but that's a little bit more early stages. We are not really there yet. So what we want to be at some point in the really future is we move this weird thing with ConnMan and WSupplicant out of the way, and we put a proper wireless daemon in there. This is what this talk about is, how we got there and how far we are actually. So the daemon is called IWD, iNet Wireless Daemon. We needed something short and sweet and short name, that was the best we came up with. And you also see that I already put in what in the white box is called Node Manager. It's kind of more the working title for this one. We want the same thing for 15.4, where you have something that manages your mesh network on 15.4 and keeps it together. So implementation of threat, for example, would fall in this category. It keeps managing your network, and ConnMan doesn't really have to only care about the IPv6 connectivity, et cetera. So, but this talk focuses on IWD. I think Node Manager may come later this year or maybe next year, depending on how far we get with that one, but that's not public yet. Every time I had to do a new daemon or start up a new project to fix something, the question was really why we actually need a new daemon. And the fundamental problems that we ran into, we couldn't fix WSupplicant to become a daemon. As I said, it isn't actually a daemon. It thinks it is one, but it really doesn't do the proper job. It only does it halfway. So the biggest problem is persistency. You kill it, you start it again, it forgot literally everything what it just did. Which is kind of neat if you willingly to reprogram everything in, but that means someone else has to store the information for you. So for example, what were your keys? What were the network you just connected to? And so on and so forth. Doesn't really work for us, since everything else on Linux side remembers things. So if you program an access point into, or what's called APN in the LTE world, into a phone, it remembered. So restart it, it crashed anything else, it will keep remembering. If you pair a device in BlueZ for Bluetooth, it remembered. You don't have to remember it. So this is like, why don't you just remember this information? Remember the keys, remember the networks are joined. But WSupplicant refuses to do that. It really refused to do this. Then you have some sort of Wi-Fi management that you still have to do, where WSupplicant goes, I don't really care about this. Go figure this out. Especially when it comes to, oh, I need to transition from this network to another one. It goes like, yeah, you can figure this out by yourself. And like, now I want you to figure out. I just want you to connect to these networks that I know and just tell me if you changed it. The only thing I want to do if I want a higher layer looking down, oh, I have to redo my IP address because I just changed the network, but all the other details I don't really care about. And it didn't really want to do this. It said, oh, someone else's problem. There's also some things where then you have to go way more deeper in where you have some specific handling on, oh, I'm running on 5 gigahertz now compared to 2.4 gigahertz and some other stuff. Where you go like, why do I care? And from a ConnMan perspective, we never really cared, but we had to carry this information around. One thing that bugged me all the time is that the number of abstractions WSupplicant has on the lower layers when it talks to the hardware are massive. I mean, it literally supports everything in the kitchen sink underneath, and it goes like, oh, I can still work on OS 10, I can still work on Windows, I can still work on with weird embedded system that nobody heard about this, and they're trying to abstract for every single hardware, which goes for me is like, maybe this hardware abstraction actually causing some of the problems that we are seeing. And they still support wireless extensions, which was like, why? We killed that one, well, we not really killed it, but it's supposed to be dead since a while ago. But all these legacy or even multiple operating system causes a certain things that we have seen where you actually block, because they don't know how to handle this one. Not all the interfaces are actually nicely asynchronous interfaces where you have notifications, something completed or something happened, which means, oh, they just sit there and wait and ponder it again. Have you done this now? Have you done this now? Have you done this? Oh, great, now I can continue. It's like, why don't we just tell it what to do, and then when it's done, it comes back to me and says, I'm done with this now. And in the meantime, I can do something else, which for us is really important because we want to sleep most of the time, and if we have something else, we actually want to do it. Which is extremely sad if you have a modern Linux system where you have config 8.2.11 that actually is fully asynchronous because it uses generic netlink, and WSupplicant treats it like a blocking interface. And I go like, ah, oh, come on. So this is WSupplicant. And we don't need most of this one. So we really want to cut down the feature. So with that one, yes, we're going to go Linux only, which is good or bad, depending on what your viewpoint on this one. But look, if you go Linux only, we can make certain assumptions on how we're going to, and what we can do there. So if I break this down, if you unfold the Swiss Army knife, and this is not a complete picture, what you see on the left is how wsupplicant and the Wi-Fi subsystem in the kernel actually going to work. And that's not even a complete picture. There's even more in there. I could put a tons of extra operating system there, tons of extra code in there, and that's really there. But fundamentally, what we have is you have the hardware, which is fine. You have the full Mac and the soft Mac support in the Linux kernel, still great. You have the Mac A211 subsystem for the soft Macs, great. And you have Config A211 for the configuration that abstracts the full Mac from the soft Mac. Sounds all reasonable, right? But then you still have, oh, we can expose this over Netlink, or we can expose it over wireless extensions. Well, okay, fine, the kernel might have to do this for backwards compatibility and that Linux doesn't shout at you that break an existing API and so on and so forth. I get this. And then it goes wsupplicant, oh, we're supporting both. We're not making any decisions. Okay, great. So that code never went out, so you can go talk to ioctls with it and you talk libnl with it. Funny stuff is if you have things that systems then try to talk both at the same time, and then it gets really confusing. It's a really bad idea. Then they go, oh, we expose some APIs. We're not just wsupplicant, we can do this on the command line. Oh, we also have a Unix socket with a control interface. Oh, hold on, wait, we also dbus 1 interface. We also do a dbus 2 interface. Or we can also support binder and God knows what else is in there. So it's like, okay, so you're trying to please everybody, which is not really helping. So and then obviously it runs on macOS, it runs on some RTOSes, and then it needs a couple of SSL functionality for WP Enterprise. And then it was, oh, we can do OpenSSL, we can do TSL, we have implemented our own TLS, and I think if you look far enough, you will probably say, oh, we also support Windows TLS and so on and so forth. So this goes on and keeps bloating. And don't believe that you will find a release that will compile in all possible combinations, because nobody is actually testing this one. Some of them they compile, and you find a lot of oftentimes if you switch one option off, it stops compiling. Anyway, what we had to do to actually squeeze this into something usable with ConnMan, and as I said, it's used in products like the Nest and other systems that have been heavily exposed. We actually wrote something that's called gsupplicant, which wraps the dbus API v2. We tried the v1 one, that never worked out. We tried the v2 one that actually got us somewhere closer. We had to write a lot of code to actually wrap that API in something that we could actually use in an asynchronous fashion and in a stateful, and make sense of the states and make it persistent, and still failed to do everything right because we never got the right set of information. And then ConnMan started using that one, but you see, it's quite big. So with that one in mind, I went and sat down and said, if we would do this from scratch, how would this actually look like, or how we want to run this? So the assumption is we keep ConnMan. We keep the kernel Wi-Fi subsystem because that was still good and use it. So we have the same separation, soft Mac, full Mac, config 8211. And I was like, okay, we're not doing wireless extensions anymore because they're blocking their ioctls. We want to do Netlink. So kick that one out. And then fundamentally, it was really just, we want IWD, and we want IWD expose this over dbus, and then have ConnMan talk to it. And we want to look at the same as what we do with, did with BlueZ and Ofono. It is stateful, it remembers the states, remember the networks, remember the passwords, and so on and so forth. So that was the idea. And with that one, we put down the list how we want to do this, and everybody basically claimed we were kind of weird in trying to re-implement wsupplicant. But at the same time, enough people keep complaining about wsupplicant, we keep finding enough errors in it and issues that even if we wanted to fix them, upstream didn't let us fix them. So we went, actually, can we just make them persistent so we actually have a mode where it will remember the networks? Yeah, you can do this if you do X, Y, Z, but that's really not safe and it really doesn't work this way, it's more for testing. Or you can't do this over dbus, you only can do this over a Unix socket. Or I have to reload the config file, and the config file format kept changing between versions. And I was like, okay, so that's not really helping. So it caused a lot of problems. But we also realized at some point is even the kernel side has a couple of issues. Because wsupplicant was the only user of an API that the kernel exposed. And we had to fix some of these things where, because it operates the config 8211 interface with Netlink in a blocking fashion, they forgot some of the signals that they're supposed to be sending. Well, the documentation says it's supposed to be happening. They actually never sent them because wsupplicant never needed them and they never bothered to fixing them. So this goes for hotplug and some other things. Most of this one that we have found so far, we actually fixed, got it upstream. There's a couple of more things coming where we actually do a couple of additions to the Netlink APIs. I give you an example. We have some of them where you basically, if the daemon dies, the kernel keeps continuing. So if your daemon that manages your network and manages your keys dies, you actually want the kernel to take down your interface. Same as if you have a, if you open a socket, a TCP socket, and the program dies, the kernel closes that TCP socket for you. You would expect that a Netlink interface would address exactly the same. It's like, okay, my managing daemon in user space is gone, please disconnect the station. Now they keep the station up and running because you magically could find it again and continue doing it. You lost all your credentials. You have no idea what state you're in. You will never get this back. So yeah, but it works for open networks. Great. So. Nevertheless, so there's a few things coming where we had a couple of additions, and most of them upstream. There's a couple of new ones coming for some of the SSI stuff, so you can do better roaming, etc. The one big thing that we had when we looked at this one, how we're going to do this, is okay. It talks generic netlink, and the generic netlink libraries that you will find and use if you're just naive, they're all bad. I'm sorry, just all. Bad. And they've been like, you can find six or different versions of it, and everybody tries to get them a little bit smaller, but they're keeping the same APIs. So if you use libnl or any variation of it one, you're wasting memory left and right because they allocate humongously large buffers because they have no idea what they're doing. They're also doing discovery of the netlink families so massively that you basically have everything in memory, which is great if you have like a command line application, you execute it, you finish it, you close it again. If you have your continuously running, you're consuming a lot of extra memory. Interestingly enough, libnl is also blocking in some areas. We're just like, okay, we're talking to an asynchronous interface and you know blocking because you have no idea how to operate this. And this goes onto the level that generic netlink has the same concept at dbus. Families can come and go as they like. You can load a kernel module and your family comes, but you can also unload and reload a kernel module and your family IDs are changing. And you need to adapt to this one. The functionality is all there to tell you about it, but you actually have to know how it works. If your command line tool, you don't really care. You discover your family, you send your command, after then you quit. Next time you do it again. If you're long-running daemon, and I'm talking years, not actually just a couple of hours, then that's not going to work. You have to handle these situations. So with that one, we said, okay, we are nowhere near close to actually just go up and write IWD. That's not going to work. So we needed to actually take one step back. And the one step back is we said, okay, we have so many projects that have so many common needs, and we'll go even further with some of these. We are building a library similar to glib that actually does this all for us, but it does it in a consistent way for system level daemons. And the library is called Embedded Linux Library. We open sourced it, shortcut is L. And we picked the word L because if you look in a dictionary, it actually means an L-shaped building. So we have the L in there again, which is our prefix for the library, and it's for Linux, so it kind of came all back together from a naming perspective that kind of made sense. So what do you get with it? You get main loops, you get signal handling, you get timeouts, asynchronous I/O. Asynchronous I/O is built into the library in a nice way. You can actually drive these things when you actually have to listen to events and want to be single-threaded. Strings, hash tables, queues, ring buffers, hardware DB support if you want to be a little bit fancy, and all this stuff that we would have to drag in from three or four different libraries. We re-implement it in a really small way so we can do this, which is the obvious thing you would do if you would do something like a glib library. But then I say, look, we're putting netlink support in there. So we put netlink support in there, including basic support for the route netlink support, so you can do something like IP, et cetera. Well, then we also wrote a really from scratch generic netlink that is fully asynchronous. So it does family discovery and tracking. So that's in there as well. We put KDBus support in there. Remember the time when KDBus was hip and the next big thing coming? Yeah, that's still in there, including gvariant support for the encoding of the payloads. Sadly, we actually have to remove this since KDBus is a dead project and never going to happen again. We also put normal DBus support in there, so it has a full its own DBus library in there, so you don't actually need to use libdbus or anything else of this one. And again, fully asynchronous, nicely maintained and really simple. Logging support can be to console, but also to the journal, so you don't, as a daemon, you don't have to worry about this. Sources you find on kernel.org in the tree, have a go at it and look at it. But that's we need, otherwise we're not going to get anywhere. So with this one, with the original idea, what we're going to do changed a little bit, but really not much. We're just going to put L as a library in there to actually talk to Netlink Gateway 11. We have AWD use it, and then we also can even use it to expose DBus interface and so on. So that one was good, great, and we got IWD running off the ground and could actually start doing something. So we got really quickly, really fast. So we could now nicely scan for networks. We could discover the hardware. We could do switch between active and passive scanning. We'd do SSI degrouping for the networks and for roaming. And open network support was really fast. it's unbelievable. It's within a day you can connect to an open wireless network and don't really have to do much with little lines of code. Was really great, really excited. But then we went, hold on a minute. Let's try to see if we can connect to an encrypted network. And then it goes like, oh, geez. So the whole the four-way handshake is done over an Ethernet port, and it's detached from config 8.11. So you actually have a synchronization problem, which we have been running in quite a bit. Instead of just having the Ethernet port go through the Netlink interface, now you open a raw socket and talk to this one. And in some cases, because the kernel schedules things differently, because one is actually in a Ethernet packet, the other one is a Netlink packet, you might get them in the wrong order. It's like, so yay, we have to work on synchronization between the four-way handshake and the keys that has to be set up. We need to figure out how to program the encryption keys and so on and so forth. So we needed a couple of crypto functionality. Key refresh goes all through user space, so the kernel's doing nothing for us. And obviously, we had now to manage the stations because we need to make sure that we can update them again. With that one all, okay, so we have to deal with this one. Fine, we knew what we were getting into. We deal with our own. We needed cryptographic support. And that's an interesting thing when you say, okay, we need cryptographic support. Everybody runs to some crypto library, libcrypt, or hey, let's take OpenSSL, that does everything for you anyway. Let's take GNU TLS, and somebody's like, I didn't really want to. So luckily, the whole discussion happened with the random numbers. So we actually decided, let's get the random number system call into L and just use this one. We knew that we were limiting it to brand newer kernels, but we also knew that we would take a while before this project gets public. So it's like, OK, fine. We just deal with this one. Then we needed pretty much AES, DES, and ARC4 support. Interestingly enough, the AF-ARC interface of the Linux kernel allows you direct access to the ciphers that the Linux kernel already has and will offload to hardware if needed. So AF-ARC is great, but AF-ARC is not performant. So if you think you can do high-performance AES operations on an AF-ARC interface in the kernel, you're paying a high penalty price with a lot of system calls. So you don't want to do it. But we looked at how many AES operations we have to do for certain key exchange operations, like we're paying four system calls for doing a four-way handshake. It's like, why do I care? The kernel can do this perfectly for me. That's not your bottleneck. So for us, it's fine. If you want to do high-performance AES operations with AF-ARC, don't do it. If you have low performance, a few AES operations, this one gets you there without having to worry about it. And we put that natively into L, so basically open the AES cipher and say, look, do this, and it goes to the kernel and does it. And if someone wants to re-abstract this with a faster user space implementation, they can. But I don't have to think about that my AES implementation or the one that I copied is correct. So we rely on the kernel doing it. We needed to do the hashes as well. Originally, we would have to do the hashes manually since the kernel had no support for hashes. But a little bit luckily, then they came along and actually also supported the hashes via AF-ARC, so we also had the hashes available, which is kind of nice. It requires a rather recent Linux kernel, but if you use a distribution that updates the kernel, everybody has a recent kernel right now. There are a few Wi-Fi specific key derivation functions that we actually had to build by ourselves. Luckily, there come always test vectors, et cetera, but we pretty much had to build these by ourselves since they are so weird on how they're defined because the input parameters are not like one. You give, this is my key, this is the how you derive it, and then you get the output key. You basically have to put in six parameters, one of them being the MAC address, one of them being something else, and God knows what, and then they go like crazy. Okay, so we would like to offload them to the kernel. We haven't figured out how because they're like way too complicated, so we did them by ourselves. There's work on a generic key derivation function in the crypto kernel. That's work in progress right now. I think it's pretty close to happening. Sadly, we don't know how to use that then for the Wi-Fi specific ones. But for thinker ones where you actually derive a symmetric cipher from an asymmetric cipher, they work perfectly. So with this one in mind, we could extend this picture. So we get a little bit bigger on the right side. But fundamentally, the only thing, OK, great. We don't have add anything to IWD or anything. We just put a little bit of crypto support in L, and that's pretty much just a shim for using the kernel AF-ARC interface in a nice way. And we put this in L because if you wanted to use the AF-ARC interface over and over again manually, it drives yourself insane because it's actually a socket. So using this with L, it gives you a little bit extra easier way to actually use this, especially if you only do have like one or two AES operations. Or if you have to do a hash, you basically have your input value and then you get it back out. Pretty easy. works out, and we had nothing to do much more. And we still didn't increase IWD massive amount. We increased L a little bit, but IWD still stayed the same size. So with this one, we were actually pretty happy. It could do nicely, wsupplicant, we thought. We can program the keys. We get the audit, everything derived. We ran into the problem that we had no idea on how to tell Netlink to use these keys. We thought we understood the documentation, but there's just a header file. And we were plain wrong. We had no idea at what point we put in the keys, what to toggle, and so on and so forth. I was like, OK, right, the standard answer to this one, read the source code. It's like, OK, fine, we did. We still couldn't figure out what to do in what order. So I was like, OK, this is not going to help us. We have a tool that already does this, so we have to understand what they're actually doing. So what we did is we took the Netlink monitor kernel driver. I had a couple of iterations for this one to make it a little bit better. But what we fundamentally ended up with, we were able to write a monitoring tool for Netlink 802.11 that you can start and then see exactly what happens between a daemon and the kernel, without actually interfacing or without having extra code or doing some of the, oh, we need to figure out at printfs or anything else. We could pretty much hook into this one, save them, store them, and process them later. So the tool is called IWMon. And besides Energy 11, it also can trace EAP. So we actually can interline the four-way handshake with the Netlink 11. And we knew exactly where these race conditions between these two sockets are happening. So that was great to see us, for us to see what's going on. And believe it or not, that helped so much to understand where things are going wrong. One of the interesting things on this one is we also saw the things where wsupplicant are doing things fundamentally wrong and where it has no idea what the interface was doing. So if you see something, I'm doing this to you, and the kernel goes back, no such device, then you'd be like, didn't we just tell you that we took this interface away and you're still trying to use it? Why? I didn't try to figure out the why, but it was like, OK, that's kind of scary. So I actually don't know if it's readable. I hope it's a little bit real. So this is an example of how NWMon will do this. It's similar to the Bluetooth monitor that we have. So if you send a Netlink message, it gets marked as a request. This, in this case, it's a trigger scan, so basically go start scanning. And then it can you get it to the ISS IDs that you have in there. So in this case, you use the test WPA access point. Please just look for this one. Then you get an event that is, oh, I'm started scanning, that goes to everybody's one, basically tells everybody, oh, I'm started scan now, and it tells you also what frequency it scans on. So if you leave the frequencies out of the request, it will actually just start scanning on all of them, but you can also have put the frequencies in the request, and it will tell you what frequency it scans on. It will tell you the response at some point that goes back to the only single process requested. So you have this nice way of, I get the feedback when my request is started, but also it tells everybody else that this is actually going on, so you know who's scanning. This doesn't help if you have a blocking client. It misses the one in between or it overlooks it. But with a fully asynchronous system, you can have multiple parts of the system really acting to this one. This is a response for me because I triggered it, but this is the event that goes to something else, which is great and helps us with the, L helped us quite a lot to actually make this nice. And then once you're done scanning, you get the information that there are new networks available and it tells you, oh, I scanned these SSIDs, I scanned on these frequencies, and there are new networks, please retrieve them now. And you run this just at the same time you're running the daemon, you can decode this one. It gets funny when you actually see when wsupplicant does something's wrong. And for that one, the tool is already by itself, going to this stage, is absolutely valuable if you have to do any diagnostic on a Wi-Fi network where you think something goes wrong, but you don't know where. So with this one in place, and then finally figuring out how you have to do the key to program the keys into the kernel and in which order and what bits to flip to actually make them active and so on and so forth, we had access point discovery. We had open access point connections. We could do WPA, WPA2, worked nicely. We could do basic roaming since we knew when we were disconnecting, then we could find it again, rescan, and so on and so forth. And we put in a couple of experimental dbus APIs so we can actually trigger this. And we had debugging tools. So we could do the tracing nicely and easily and capture the traces, store them, and you can even open them in Wireshark if you want to do a little more graphical analysis. But more importantly, we can actually store them in PCAP formats and then keep sending the PCAP format around, which was great when Dennis, for example, did something in Austin and said, oh, look at this one, he just sent me the PCAP file, and I go, okay, yeah, that looks funny. Instead of just having sent like text files around, analyze them, I could just open the binary on my side and can really go through a scroll thread and go forth and back. And we had additional L logging for dbus and generic netlink if you wanted to see if we are doing something wrong, so we could actually have switch on extra debugging there and then get the messages spilled out. So far, really, really great. So I said, okay, this is great. We got this going, and we need a little bit more complex things. So interestingly enough, we were looking at IWD more like we shrink the code size so we can make it on Linux-based IoT devices that are small. If you look at IoT for IoT devices and Wi-Fi, they're mostly headless. And once you run the headless case, nobody wants to do WP2. They all think, oh, we want enterprise Wi-Fi, so they want certificate-based authentication. I was like, okay, now that gets a little bit more complicated. So we need X509 certificates, and we need TLS. And we don't want to do GNU TLS or OpenSSL. Mainly two complex APIs. They're huge. They do blocking operations for their setups. And we rather have our own eApp engine integrated nicely instead of just using trying to use something else. So it's like, okay, we were at a cross point again. It's like, what to do now? And then we ended up, okay, another step back and see what's going on. So interestingly enough, Linux has secure boot support. Secure boot means you have to deal with X509 certificates. The Linux kernel also has keyrings. And they're pretty much as close as to a certificate chain or a CA, a trust chain, as you can get it. And the Linux kernel is using them this way. So you get your certificates, you can build them in, you get them from a TPM, you get something else, and then if your certificates match, I keep booting and I do things. The only problem is that's the kernel internal functionality. So none of this one is really exposed to user space. Yes, you can load your certificates in there, but you can't create keyrings that you actually can seal and use as CAs. I'm like, okay. And then you had no RSA operations to actually use them because you still have, once you have a certificate, you still have to turn them into a symmetric cipher from your asymmetric one. So this is still a little bit of work in progress. We're not completely done with it. Not all of patched in the upstream, but we actually have this in Martin's tree, in Matt's tree to actually test this. So if you take Matt's tree and you take an updated version of L, you get full keyring support and full certificate support without having to actually go for GNU TLS and OpenSSL. So you can take your certificate, load it in, sign it, verify it, and then you get your symmetric cipher back out of it and push it back into an AS operation. And that's all you fundamentally need for doing Wi-Fi enterprise support. There's a little bit more, but this is the big main item that is getting in your way. With this key handling, the things we pushed into L was base64 encoding and decoding. The kernel people are a little bit stringent on which formats they're going to accept. And while I didn't want to put a base64 encoder and decoder into L, but that's what we had to do. It's like, that's the minimum thing. That's fine. PEM was a little bit, oh, Jesus. Let me put it this way. All the certificates have has really weird formats. And if you dig through the IFCs or the documentation long enough, it drives you crazy. Then again, we have RSA key and keyring support now in L and actually can use RSA for asymmetric ciphers, and it's pretty nice. TLS support, we want it in the kernel, but I think this will happen, but this will take a longer road to actually get there. And we are not alone with there. We want this for Wi-Fi, but companies like Facebook and Google want this pretty much for the enterprise side where they want to have TLS support in the kernel. And I think it's going to happen. For now, we have the TLS record protocol implemented in L. And that's a small price to pay if the certificates are handled by the kernel. I can accept to implement TSL record protocol myself because it's a protocol. We can test this, we can unit test this, and I have high confidence in them. If I would have to redo the certificates in a user space library, I wouldn't have the high confidence. But these are all low-hanging fruits that let's do them and we can get this going. So we actually have TLS support in L now, and you can just use it to talk to the W Enterprise on your access point. So small change to the basic diagram, so it grew a little bit bigger, but not as massively. Besides the FARC now, we're actually using the key control system calls. No increase to the user space, except a little bit of handling and a little bit of extra protocols, but it's minimal in comparison to an OpenSSL or GNU TLS library. And we have the key control system call, and we extended these ones with verify, sign, and so on. And there's a little bit extra work coming that's not yet merged for the sealed keyrings, but pretty much you would have a certificate authority inside the kernel. So the interesting part is nobody realizes with this work, the keyrings inside the kernel are actually shareable between processes because they have access permissions. And what you could fundamentally do with this one is have systemd load all your certificates at boot time, create a keyring, seal it off, and then hand it to every process. So if your process starts, it already has the certificate authority of your system available because it's inside the kernel, and you don't have to go and I have to read 300 files from disk and make sure that they're all there. It's one process doing one time, and you can share them around. It's a nice feature. For that one, to obviously make big use, you would have to change OpenSSL and GNU TLS to actually use that feature and rely on that the certificates are in the kernel. We're not going to do that work. I'm just putting this out there. That's an idea. Some people can work on this one. But with this one in place, we have EAP TLS working, we have EAP TTLS working, and we also then went a little bit further. Why it has nothing to do with certificates, but the WPS, so the automatic system for retaining the WP2 passphrases, we implemented that as well because we had to do the EAP engine for the enterprise ones, and that one is just the EAP engine then used a little bit differently. And so we had this one as well, and we got, oh, great. So we have these ones, and people could actually start working on this one. With that one, we went a little bit further on this one as well. All the protocols we put in have unit tests. So everything we did as a protocol level has a unit test. They're massive unit tests in IWD. We actually make sure that we did this right, especially for the record protocol and things like that. This is really important. But we also went one step further. It's like, look, guys, I cannot go around and actually test against every access point and go again. So we need some level of automated testing to be ensuring that we actually keep roaming properly, that we keep connecting access point, that we don't break simple stuff like WP2 and so on and so forth. So the Linux kernel has an HWSIM driver that is pretty much virtual air. It emulates two or multiple cards and then pretends to be a softmac, and then they just keep the packets sending them left and right. So it's virtual air, it's perfect, for obvious reasons. It has a couple of code that actually can inject errors and drop packets, but it's otherwise, it's going to perfect, but that's fine. You can use it at least for testing your protocols. So we built a tool for actually managing these, HWSIM, so we can actually finally have a tool that manages them. Because before they had the driver, kernel driver, but then it was manual setup, and you actually, oh, I have to create this one, I have to create this one. So HWSIM does a lot of monitor creation for you. We duplicated, in this case, we haven't really figured out how to share the code, the test runner tool from BlueZ. Test runner is a tool that allows you to pick a new kernel, start it in KVM, inject yourself and run yourself as init one, and then do some unit testing on this one. So it's pretty much use your existing your file system you have in your system and then start with a new kernel and then you can test it. And we extended that with IWD support, host AP support, and also the HWSIM setup. So you can actually say, oh, I need three network cards that need to be connected in this way, and then please execute this unit test. And then you can have automated end-to-end testing really quickly. And we can test most of these test cases within a couple of minutes instead of just spending time to the setup. So that's all there, and we keep improving this one over and over again. We have a bunch of test scripts. As with usual, we did all the basic tests for manual testing in Python. They're talking to the dbus APIs. They get you going. They're never nothing for production, but they get you going. So with this one, what are we going to have? The daemon is ready. It's open source. It's ready to go. Open networks, WP2 and WP1, EAPTLS, EAPTLS, wireless protected setup, WPS. The EAP engine works. It's kind of nice. We need to figure out how we actually extract that EAP engine into something where we can also use for wired setups and maybe move this into L or something else can be reused. We are not there yet. That's going to happen. We have roaming and fast transitions, so that's supported as well. We have persistent storage, so you kill the daemon, restart it. It will find your network and connect to it, so you don't really have to do anything. And we have a dbus API that is early stages, but we have it. We have the tracing utility, IWMon, and we have the testing framework, the HWSIM and test runner, where you can test this. And we also now have a ConnMan plugin. The last time I gave this talk in Berlin about a couple of months ago, we didn't have this ConnMan plugin. Luckily, we have the ConnMan plugin now, thanks to Daniel, who pushed that through. The interesting thing is when I compared the size to what we needed to do with gsupplicant and the plugin, it's 10% of the code size that we had to do to actually make ConnMan use IWD and B connect to Wi-Fi networks. That's a massive decrease in functionality we don't have to maintain anymore, which is great. So awesome on that one. With this one, I have a couple of slides on how the APIs, dbus APIs work. They will be stabilized eventually, and we keep working on them and improving them. But they're really, really simple. You can enumerate your device hierarchy and tells you which cards are there. So put multiple Wi-Fi cards if you want to. If you want to put 10 in the system, go ahead, knock yourself out, put 10 in them or more. We have a network hierarchy that is pretty much simple. It tells you what the network is, and you can connect to it. As simple as this one. We have an agent. If you actually have any kind of BlueZ and phone and all of these do this way. If you want to have the user show them a dialog to enter the password, you register an agent, and then you basically get a request for the passphrase, and you just send it back, and then it works. So it's fully asynchronous and allows nice integration with the UI. We have also the one for actually what networks you know, and then you can use them and delete them. So the networks, the APIs are all documented in text files, and there are a few more now by now. So you can work on them. And this would be like a simple way of how you're going to do it. You would start IWD, and then you just go list devices, and it will tell you what network cards in there, and it will list which device one, because it will keep scanning and find the devices for you in the background. It does this all kind of in a nice fashion. If you then want to connect to it, you just pick out the object pass on the debug side, connect to it, start a simple agent if it's encrypted. And this was the case. I did this testing in Berlin with a Linux network. I would have demoed this one out as well, but accidentally put the wrong Wi-Fi dongle in my bag, and that doesn't have an upstream driver yet, and I couldn't bother to actually fix that. And then you just can run DHCP test from ConnMan on it, and you get the DHCP address, and it's really instantly and works really great. So that's a basic way to actually test this and get on. There's a lot of things to do. So we're missing still a lot of things that are work on. One of them is IW control. So with all the other projects, we have a command line tool, so you don't have to always write a UI. You have a command line tool that uses the DBus APIs, and then you can basically go connect to this one, disconnect to this one. That's happening, but I don't know when this is happening. We need a little bit more. There's some other more high priority items, so if someone wants to pick up and work on this one, there's a skeleton for this one. Go ahead and please work on this one. Connection manager integration. As I said, we have ConnMan support, so that's great. That's really what we cared about. There's no plugin for network manager, and we're not going to do this. We have really no interest in that. ConnMan was our main objective. But if someone wants to do this, I think this would be a great idea to have for a project to see what difference does this make if you use Network Manager with IWD compared to WSupplicant and how more stable it gets. There's currently no integration with SystemD NetworkD, but we are looking into this one, how we can actually integrate IWD with SystemD NetworkD and make SystemD use Wi-Fi really early on for systems that actually don't use ConnMan. Roaming and access point steering. This is really the one thing that we want to do next, where we actually want to have a more, no, we want to have a little bit more advanced roaming policy, where we actually do scan networks ahead of time and see if you're around. And even if you disconnect and reopen it again, scan your previous ones, or the last two or three previous ones, on the frequencies you think they are there before you go and scan your whole band. This is really important for 5 GHz operation, because the scanning on 5 GHz or the full 5 GHz band is really expensive, because it takes a long time. So if you have a good idea where you are and what's around you, then you can do a lot more optimized scanning operation and connect really faster. It's all about, okay, let's get back to my original network or the network that are now really fast. There's a lot of things that has to be working there. We have to make sure that we know which network is connected to, and so on and so forth. Obviously, you have the always fall case. You jump on the plane in one planet, and then you, continent, get off the other continent. These all heuristics were going to fail. But if you walk from, say, from here to the coffee shop, it should take you literally a couple of microseconds to actually get on the right network, instead of just having to waste 3 or 4 seconds to get on it, or every minutes. This is also really needed for 2.4 GHz and 5 GHz operation, because you want to switch between 2.4 and 5 GHz really fast and not wait, because it causes user experience interference, and we don't really want to do this. So this is work in progress. A lot of the fast transition stuff we're going to have, a couple of the RSI trigger points we don't have yet. We have patches for the Linux kernel. Hopefully they're going upstream soon. That will actually allow you a little bit of easier decision making, is when you're losing your signal strength, especially when you're moving. We have done no offloading capabilities. So a lot of hardware actually has offloading capabilities for some of the scan operations or four-way handshakes and so on and so forth. They're coming, so we have to catch up with this one as soon as the kernel supports it and we have hardware supports it. We have to offload some of this stuff. It will happen. DBus API is currently not stable. It needs API review. And we need a little bit of extra dogfooding. So ConnMan is already good to have dogfooding. IW control would be even better to have an extra dogfooding. The Hilton Wi-Fi just kicked me out. Excellent. So we need extra dogfooding on this one, and it will happen, and then we can make the API stable. But if people have comments on this one, great, please send them to the mailing list, because the more comments on this one, the better. We don't have any fancy Wi-Fi features. So one of them that has to happen eventually, where IWD and Ofone has to work together, is the Passpoint 2.0 feature, where we actually use your SIM card to authenticating. And in the past, this hasn't been really that prominent. There was a couple of, some countries do this, you find an access point every now and there. But it seems some of the telcos are pushing this a little bit quicker now, where you actually can then offload their Wi-Fi network to their hotspots, and they're using the SIM cards to authenticate. I've actually never used it in a real world. I've used this in the lab, but I've never seen this in the real world really working, but I've heard that some people have used it. P2P and Miracast, Wi-Fi Direct and Miracast, we have not looked into, and I have no idea, honestly, if we will. So if someone wants to contribute P2P support, I make it work, great, if they figure out a way how, but I don't know if that's the one of the main objectives. Neighborhood-aware networking is the next big hype thing. Let's see. We're not actively focused on it. There's other things to do, but we're not looking into this one heavily. I think before we get to any of these ones, we will actually implement the access point mode, so we actually have host AP support or equivalent for this one in it. Source code is available since 4 or 5 months now. It's also on kernel.org. L and the crypto trees are available as well. I had Matt's tree there. What we haven't done yet, and this is what we're starting pretty much probably next week or so, we actually are going to start making releases of L and IWD, so you actually can get tarballs and build them, and if someone wants to integrate in a distro as well. Currently, it's just Git trees that you can build. They're really easy to build because you have almost no dependency. So L depends on nothing except your C library. IWD depends on L and your C library, and that's about it. And IWD is also created in a way that it can have an integrated copy of L, so fundamentally, you can build this on a system with just having the C library. So it is really has no dependency, except you need a kernel that supports AFALC and the keyring key control if you want to use these features. If the keyrings are not there, it will still work, but you will not be able to use the WP Enterprise. That's about it. So with that one, I'm actually done. So do we have any questions? Go ahead. So the question was, do we have offer any help so between access point mode and client mode? So right now, the answer is we don't have access point mode yet because that was not on our focus. But once we have access point mode, yes, we will allow this. You can actually operate them at the same time if the hardware supports it, or allow easy switching of them so you don't have to, oh, we need to load a different kernel driver, or we need to delete a different firmware. That should be nobody's problem. That should be all abstracted. So either we're going to fix the kernel interface and the drivers for it, or we have to figure out something else. But that's the idea. But we're not there yet. So the question was, how far is host AP support or access point mode support? We have zero line of code for this one. But that said, we have all the crypto primitives and everything else is actually there. And the kernel does a lot of work with the beacons and the actually setup. So my estimate is if someone really wants it, they wouldn't need a lot to make this fly because the heavy lifting is get all the crypto in place. So we get to this one. If you want to do it before we get to it, great. We would happy to get external contributions. Yes, please. So I heard what it would take to add, and then it's blank. Yeah, hold on. So that's a good. Oh, yeah. So the interesting part is, since we're actually using the kernel keyrings, if the kernel understands your TPM or your hardware-based certificate storage, you don't have to do anything. It will just work. The only thing you need to know is your key ID. So PCSC 11, I don't know. With TPMs, it will work really easily. PCSC 11, I frankly don't don't know enough if we get them abstracted as a kernel driver or something similar. Yeah, so wsupplicant uses a library that loads some module, that loads something else, and then eventually it goes to the SIM card reader and hopefully gets some credentials out of this one or whatever reader you're going to use. If the kernel can't support an abstraction for this one, I don't think we're going to do it. I know that a lot of people are working on TPM 1.2 and TPM 2.0 support, and that one we will support off the shelf. That actually works right now. If you have an RSA key infused in TPM hardware or Intel's Quick Assist or pick any random hardware that actually has RSA support, we can actually utilize this. And we don't have to do anything for it. So buying a USB SIM card reader off the shelf and sticking a card in there and hoping to use that one to authenticate, I frankly don't have any idea. Interesting to look into. You're more than welcome to figure something out. I don't have a real answer for that one. We are net set on not using OpenSSL and GNU TLS. So that we're dead set on that. Yes, please.
Does WPS work without the additional kernel extensions? There's kernel extensions that aren't in yet.
Oh, yeah. So WPS will work without the keyring extensions. So it will work right now. You can use an off-the-shelf 4.7 or 4.8 kernel. I think the only thing you need is one of the hashes by AFALC. So that works off the shelf now. Any other questions? Yes, please.
I can see the advantage of the software architecture. Once this is all up and running, how is it going to have better performance?
So how is this going to, the question is, how is this going to be any different once you have this all up and running? So the difference is that it actually will work. So that sounds a bit harsh, but and wsupplicant works as well, right? We have their systems out in the wild that work, and it works for a while, and every now and then something goes wrong. So the problem with wsupplicant is it swallows states. And in some cases, it has no idea what it's doing. And that was our fundamental problem with some of the other. It all works, you connect to it, or you start it from the command line, or you kill it, you start it again, you're all good. But we were envisioning something where you have to run this for years. And you don't want to restart the daemon or kill it or enter a sleep 5 because that's the only way to make this work. So we needed something fully asynchronous, which means we needed to know what's happening. And what we've seen wsupplicant swallow states, that they acknowledge this one. Or we coalesce all the states into one. It's like to make an efficient roaming decision, we needed to know those two states before. It's like why you actually did that. That we fixed. And upstream, wsupplicant never wanted to take it. They go like, oh, no, we know better. Some of the things were also that because of the swallowing of the states, you actually couldn't figure out what to do next. And sometimes they actually probed the hardware so many times and didn't know why. So you can say what you want. Wireless extension was fundamentally broken. Config 8.11 had a couple of issues that we fixed. But besides that, it was actually pretty decent a wireless subsystem in the kernel that abstracts multiple pieces of hardware. So when we did the testing with an upstream driver that actually has no weird behavior and goes all through config 8.11 properly, we didn't have to do any hooks. Oh, this is a Intel hardware, this is a Marvell hardware, this is a Qualcomm hardware. They all behave fundamentally the same. And that was kind of nice because we didn't have to probe this or, oh, we pull it twice, then we get the right response. No, once you drive the interface correctly, you get the right information at the right time and can make the right decision. So yes, you will be able to connect, but we are looking at being able to connect for a long time, stay connected, roam between networks, and don't have the full shutdown. There's a couple of things. Sometimes I see when I use my MacBook somewhere, and then it completely screws itself over. And you have no idea why. It can reboot it, and once the Wi-Fi hardware loses power, then they get back into a useful state. But this means somewhere in the time, they actually lost all the information they had and were doing something weird. And we want to get rid of this one. So yes, it will all connect, but I think the experience that you get with IWD is a lot better than whatever you can do with wsupplicant. And yes, some companies made wsupplicant work really well, and they hammered it into shape, and they tested the crap out of it. But I don't want to do that. I want something that just works. And that's the fundamental idea behind it. And we hope it's smaller from the size point of view, I mean the overall system, because WSupplicant itself can be compiled really tiny, and they're always advertising there's so many options, but you're paying the price by actually putting all these abstractions and shims on top of it to make it usable. So I think the whole concept will be a lot smaller. And as I said, 10% size reduction for our ConnMan plugin. Yay, that's already massive. I hope that answers your question. It was a longer winded one, but that's why we did it. Yeah, ask someone that had to feel the pain points of WSupplicant, and I think then you get this really quickly. Yeah. ConnMan did a lot of band-aids. We called them G-supplicant. They were all our band-aids in that area, and there were a lot of more band-aids. So what Daniel said is we realized that a lot of the Wi-Fi issues, we had to fix them in ConnMan because WSupplicant was only giving us half information. And it's bad when you do have guesswork. When you put compliance in here, so I think that state transition means that. But in some cases, might also mean that. I'm sorry, that's not deterministic. That's just wildly guessing something. Play roulette, that's more reliable than actually doing that one. And that's what WSupplicant sometimes did with it, just played pure roulette with it. And if you look down, and that's why AWMon is actually kind of interesting. If you want to convince someone, take your system with WSupplicant, take IWE, compile IWMon, and start it, and then see how many red-lined errors you're going to get where WSupplicant sends something to the kernel and the kernel tells you no such interface or no such device. You go like, why are you doing this? And why are you doing this 6 times in a row? I already told you it's not there. So then you might can convince somebody. It's too bad that I don't have a dongle with me that I can just use. Otherwise, I would demonstrate this to you with this layers to see. There's another question, please. I like that term. Full-time WSupplicant babysitter. Can you repeat this again?
Once I get my network connection,
yeah.
I'm going to pass the encryption traffic.
Yeah.
Today, I will be with you or BlueZ.
Yeah.
So the systems have not relied on those libraries since then.
So. The library is fine if you want to go threaded. So if you are accepting the premise that you build a threaded application, GNU TLS and OpenSSL will just fine. You put in a separate thread, you're going to go HTTPS and go to all good and golden, right? Our promise was we actually want to be single-threaded, fully asynchron. And it doesn't work with OpenSSL and GNU TLS. The time it sometimes takes to do some of these handshakes, we could do be something else already and be done with it. So you have to, if you have that premise at that point, you have two choices. Either you implement your own TLS library and run with it, which I really didn't want to do, mainly because of all the certificate handling, or you use the kernel one as we did. So that's the decision you're going to make. The nice advantage is if you have a really small Linux system, like less than a megabyte that does a specific job, but it needs actually a WP enterprise connection, you can actually use this and send your data over this one. Because you have your one-to-one authentication, not a shared key, you have real certificates, and then they can send data, and you know it's encrypted, you can trust this. So this would be like a small sensor, big enough to run Linux, and then you can just send the data, and then off you go, and you don't have to worry about anything anymore. And there are cases where you don't have GNU TLS. I've also seen cases, and this is a real-life example, where we have companies that actually have GNU TLS in there, but they don't want the memory overhead when you actually link it into your application, in every application, because they're size constrained and resource constrained every application individually. And they go like, oh, if I need this application to be big again because it has the GNU TLS library, I don't want that memory overhead because I want to keep that small so I actually can make sure that I can swap this out appropriately. So there are It doesn't make always sense, but there are some cases where this actually makes a lot of sense to say, we're not going to link in GNU TLS into every single application. And we definitely don't link in this daemon, because then we can size constrain the daemon. And we have actually seen this with ConnMan. ConnMan actually can link against GNU TLS for whisper support, so hotspot login and crazy stuff like that. And we have companies saying, no, we don't want this. We don't need this, because we're only running in a home, so we don't really want this. And by the way, because you did this, we actually have our system manager kill that process because you're actually over-utilizing your resources. So there are reasons for doing this one in cases, but we will stay with the resistance because we will stay single-threaded. That's the main conceptual design that we have made, and we're not going to move this around. Because we would move away from this one, we have to go multi-threaded. We have to do all the locking, and then the code becomes multiple to it's more complex. So I'd rather take a hit for not using GNU TLS and OpenSSL, and people blame me for doing this one, than actually having to be blamed for, oh, this deadlock somewhere. That's the main philosophy behind it. I hope that explains why we're insisting on this one. Any other questions? Then thanks, everybody, and have a good rest of the conference. One last talk or so.